Good morning, Church of the Resurrection. Let us worship together. Would you please stand? Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Let us sing together. Please kneel or be seated as you are able. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Let us take a moment and confess our sins against God and our neighbor, kneeling or seated as you are able. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen.
Please stand. Lord, open our lips.
And our mouth shall proclaim your praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The earth is the Lord's, for he made it.
Come, let us adore him.
Be joyful in the Lord,
all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song. Know this, the Lord himself is God. He himself has made us, and we are his. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and call upon his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his faithfulness endures from age to age.
The earth is the Lord's, for he made it.
Come, let us adore him. Our New Testament reading is taken from 1 John chapter 1, from verse 1 to 4. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest, and we have seen it, and testify to it, and proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Good morning, Church of the Resurrection. I have the honor of introducing us to a new book that we're going to be studying for the next 2 months throughout the summer. We just finished studying the book of Galatians. And Galatians has been talking about, Paul has been talking about in Galatians, how our acceptability before God is based upon the cross, how we are reconciled not by what we do, but by who we know, Jesus Christ. We are saved by faith through grace alone. That's what Galatians is about. And there's a logical sense in what our next study is going to be on, the book of 1 John. Because the book of 1 John is a book of assurances. How do we know that we are actually saved? What does that look like in practice? What are some things that we can look at to assure us that we are saved, to give us confidence in our salvation, give us confidence in what we know about God? And that's what the book of 1 John talks about. It reads like a sermon, not like a letter. Now, you'll notice from Galatians how Paul builds his case point by point, you know, argument upon argument. But John doesn't actually do that. What he does is presents information in a cyclical manner. So he'll mention something about love, for example, and then later on he'll mention that same thing about love, but then he'll add a little bit more information. And that's how he writes, cyclically. He talks about love, about light, about truth, about fellowship, replete in all the letters. This book is just 5 chapters long. It's a very easy read, but it is going to take us 2 months to go through it because it has a lot in it. We think most likely that it was written by the Apostle John. There are several Johns that could have written the letter, but Apostle John is probably the most likely. And we believe he wrote it between 80 to 90 AD. So I want you to take a moment and picture that you are with the Apostle John, and he's about to start writing this letter. This old veteran in the faith. He sighs deeply because he's worried. Something weighs heavily on his heart. The churches that he's about to write to, the churches in Ephesus, are going through a particular crisis, and he's trying to figure out the best way to tell them what to do and to encourage them. And his words are important because this is someone who was with Jesus from the very beginning. These are the words of a warrior who has seen a lot. And he knows that his time on earth is short. What's the crisis? There were several things, but one of them was the encroaching of this new doctrine that was rising up. Later on, they'll give it a name, Gnosticism. But at this point, it was just beginning to come into the church. And it taught a couple of things that were very dangerous to Christians. One of the things it taught was that the only way you could be saved was if you had some specific type of knowledge, arcane knowledge, that was only available to a select few. So again, we see a situation where there's a difference in citizenship in the kingdom, those who knew and those who did not know, those who were in and those who were out. And so John is going to tell the church later on, look, you have all knowledge. You have the Holy Spirit. You don't need anyone to tell you differently. But the second thing that Gnosticism taught was that matter is evil, but everything spiritual, what you couldn't see, your soul, was good. Now, that's a problem because two extremes arose out of this. One was asceticism, the idea that because my body is evil, I have to make sure that I subject it to the harshest discipline and subject it to the harshest rule so that it doesn't force me into sin. That was one thing that this lie produced. Second thing was a form of libertarianism. You know, if matter is evil, oh, that's great. I can do whatever I want with my body because it's not redeemable. It's going to go to hell anyway. My spirit is saved. My soul is secure, so it's fine. I can sin all I want to sin, all that I want. I can drink. I can sleep around. It doesn't matter. And this is what John wants to refute. So you see him pick up his papyrus, and you see him pick up his pen, and he kind of furrows his brow. How do I start this letter? What opens this? And almost immediately, light bulb, you know, because he realizes he has to start from the beginning. The churches need to understand that Jesus Christ was a real historical figure. He was a person in history. They needed incarnational assurance. And so that's how he starts his letter. And that's what our passage today deals with. 1 John chapter 1 from verse 1 to 4. Incarnational assurance. Before we begin, let's pray. Father, we pray that the opening of your word will bring us life. Please speak to us through your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen. Verse 1 starts with that which was from the beginning. Now, the moment you read that clause, one passage should come to mind, and that's John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. And of course, you think of Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And then you find out from John chapter 1, verse 14 later on that this word became flesh. And in the mind of his readers, when they read that which was from the beginning, immediately they're thinking, Jesus. So John is going to start his letter by talking about Jesus. Jesus, who is the one who was from the beginning. Look at the descriptors. What about Jesus? Which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands concerning the word of life. Notice the we's. From the very beginning, he's saying, look, this is something that I have experienced. I and others have an eyewitness account. We're giving you eyewitness accounts of what we experienced. And we experienced Jesus. We heard him. Now, the way the verb heard is formed in the Greek gives the impression of like, you know, they heard Jesus speak, but his voice is currently still ringing in their ears. So Jesus is still ringing in John's ear, which we have seen. Again, same thing. You know that feeling you get, or that experience of looking at something really, really bright, like the sun or a floodlight or something, and then when you look away and you close your eyes, that after image remains behind. You can still sort of see the after image. That's the idea here. John is saying we have seen Jesus. And because we have seen him and he's so brilliant and glorious, we continue to see Jesus. And he doesn't fade like an after image, which we looked upon, or if you want to translate it differently, which we beheld. And this is more than just seeing. It has a sense of intense, contemplative gaze. You know, it's deeper than just seeing something. It's not that you're looking. You're trying to find out more about it by looking and beholding it. And have touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This signifies a deliberate testing. They're searching out by hand. And in the case of John, he had physical interaction with Jesus Christ. They ate together. They laughed together. They hugged each other. I mean, this was the disciple who placed his head on Jesus' chest at the Last Supper. And what John is saying here is that he was real. I mean, just notice the senses: hearing, seeing, touching. John is telling his readers, Jesus is real. The incarnation is an irrevocable historical event. And you can't say otherwise about it. Jesus wasn't a vision. He wasn't a phantom. He was a concrete reality. There was a sort of a legend that went on that basically Jesus didn't have a body. Why? Because matter is evil. If matter is evil, then Jesus couldn't have had a body because Jesus wasn't evil. In fact, if you walked beside Jesus on the beach and you looked behind you, you wouldn't see any footsteps because Jesus didn't have a real body. And so the resurrection also wasn't real. Here John says, no, I had a personal experience with Christ. He was real. He had a physical body. He was real. But also, look at the type of verbs that he's using. Discovering Jesus for himself was very important. And how does he know that the incarnation was real, that Jesus was actually a human being? He says he heard Jesus, then he saw Jesus, then he looked upon Jesus, then he touched Jesus. And that's the natural progression to salvation. We hear the word of Christ first through the preaching of the gospel, because how can we believe if nobody, you know, preaches the word to us? And then we see Jesus in the gospel. And then we begin to contemplate this Jesus. We look upon him. What does he want of me? What is he saying? Is what he's saying actually true? What do I do with what he's saying? And then the Holy Spirit moves us to embrace him in new life. He says, take hold of Jesus. And it is through this process that we receive the assurance that Jesus Christ is God in the flesh. That's how we are saved. And that's how John came to the truth, and that's how you and I come to the truth. And in verse 2, which is a parenthetical, John begins by saying, The life was made manifest. That which was from the beginning is now said to be life. And this life was manifested. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And so when he became flesh, life became flesh. John 1:14. But the life is also eternal life. It's described as eternal. And that's important because, you know, when you read that which was from the beginning, you might say, oh, Jesus had a beginning. You know, there was a point at the beginning that God created the Son. But no, John is saying this was eternal life. Jesus has always been. There was no point where he was not. And this is important because the eternal Jesus, that which was from the beginning for all eternity, is what became flesh. Jesus is a man, but he is much more than a man. Jesus is a good teacher, but he is much more than a good teacher. Jesus is a prophet, but he is much more than just a prophet. Jesus is God, the eternal life who was from the beginning. And any other Jesus that does not fit with this Jesus of history that John experienced is not the true Jesus. It's not. There is no way for that Jesus to be real. Our Jesus is real. There's a quote from C.S. Lewis that demands, I think everybody should know. It's familiar, and I love it because it's telling us that we have only a couple of responses to who Jesus actually is. Here's the quote. "I am trying here to prevent anyone saying the really foolish thing that people often say about him, Jesus." This is what they say. "I'm ready to accept Jesus as a great moral teacher, but I don't accept his claim to be God. That is the one thing we must not say." That's what C.S. Lewis says. "A man who was merely a man and said the sort of things Jesus said, would not be a great moral teacher. He would either be a lunatic, on the level with the man who says he is a poached egg, or else he would be the devil of hell." You know, you must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman or something worse. You can shut him up for a fool. You can spit at him and kill him as a demon, or you can fall at his feet and call him Lord and God. But let us not come with any patronizing nonsense about his being a great human teacher. He has not left that open to us. He did not intend to. That's from Mere Christianity. And C.S. Lewis is right. We believe that Jesus is God, and he is the one that came in flesh. The incarnation is real because that which was from the beginning, that which was life eternal, became flesh. And John experienced it. So have we. John goes on to say that because of this assurance of the incarnation, those who witnessed it just had to proclaim it. Incarnational assurance led them to proclaim the incarnation. "And we have seen it," he says in verse 2, "and testify to it, and proclaim to you the eternal life." One way to interpret that verse is, "and we have seen it and are witnessing and announcing it to you all," right? So when John and the others were confronted with the incarnation and they verified that this is true, the next thing for them to do was to declare it, to proclaim it, to tell everyone. I mean, normally when you witness something amazing, something wonderful, something happens to you, some great thing happens to you, you want to share it with the world. I mean, unless of course you're the Grinch, but otherwise you want to share it with the rest of the world, to share the good news. So because we have experienced Jesus Christ, we share Jesus Christ. We don't keep him to ourselves. No, we want the whole world to hear about it. But it's not a one-time thing either. Not only do we share and witness to Jesus, we keep on doing it. We keep on witnessing, we keep on announcing it to other people, that which we have experienced. And even though very few people alive today can say they've had a tangible, a physical experience with Jesus Christ, each of us has had a concrete, tangible experience with Christ, because each of us who has come to faith in him have been forgiven of our sins and reconciled to God. Now, notice that this proclamation that John has in mind is primarily to the people who are reading his letter. You know, Christians. He's saying that we keep announcing and testifying Christ to you who are already Christians. Of course, we're going to announce to unbelievers the truth of the incarnation. But even once they become believers, we still continue to announce and declare who Jesus Christ is, what we've experienced with him, what he's doing in our lives. You know, when we meet people, we have the immediate tendency to ask, you know, where are you from? What do you do? And those are important questions. People are important. We want to get to know them. As believers, we should also start learning to share our testimonies. And ask fellow brothers and Christians who come to our services or who we meet elsewhere, we should ask them, how did you come to faith in Christ? What is the Lord teaching you right now? What are your gifts? How can I be praying for you? Because that's what we have in common. I'd actually encourage you today, if you meet another brother in Christ, or another sister in Christ, Ask them about their faith. Ask them what the Lord is teaching them. Ask them when they came to faith in Christ. And for me, that sometimes, that kind of feels uncomfortable because it feels like, oh, that's a personal question. Well, yes, it is a personal question. But remember what Scripture says in Revelation. We have overcome the devil by the blood of the Lamb, the cross, and the word of our testimony. So we should continue proclaiming what Christ is doing in our lives. So that proclamation naturally produces something. Fellowship. We know that the incarnation is real, and because it's real and we've experienced it, we proclaim it. And once we proclaim it, there is fellowship with the people we proclaim it with, if they come into fellowship. That's what verse 3 tells us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. Our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. The purpose of that proclamation is so that we'll have fellowship with those whom we proclaim it to. There should be something about unbelievers that when we look at them and we're like, I need to share Christ with that person. I want to have fellowship with them. And there needs to be something about the way we look at believers that's like, oh, I've got to tell them what Jesus is doing in my life. I need to share it with them because I want to have fellowship with them. It's when we share the proclamation of Christ that our fellowship actually deepens. The word fellowship, the word that's translated fellowship, doesn't refer to just church socials or res group meetings. It's not small group meetings or dinner gatherings. Those things are good, and they can foster fellowship. In fact, they do oftentimes. But it's actually referring to a deep communion, a sharing of things in common that goes beyond the meeting itself into heart-to-heart exchange. That's what we see in Acts chapter 2, verse 42. I'm going to read it. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. There are so many things that could be said about this passage regarding fellowship. I just want to point out one thing. Notice how their fellowship was magnetic. It was like an evangelistic tool. Like people who were not believers saw how they fellowshiped together and were drawn to the faith. And I pray that our fellowship as a church does that, that we recognize that hospitality, that true fellowship with other believers is an evangelistic tool, that people who don't know Christ will see how we love one another and be drawn to him. And God will add to our number day by day. But this kind of fellowship is not possible if you do not have fellowship with the Father and the Son, because this is supernatural. The proclamation of the incarnate Christ leads to fellowship with the Father and the Son, which consists in the fact that Christians are partakers in common of the same mind as God and Christ, and of the blessings arising from there. There's no way to have that deep communion unless you're connected to the Father and to the Son. No such thing as a Christian who does not believe in God the Father and God the Son. But also, notice that you cannot have a relationship with God the Father if you do not have fellowship with God the Son. The exclusive nature of our faith is clear. Jesus said that I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. No one. In Acts chapter 4, I believe verse 12, Peter speaks to the Sanhedrin and he says to them, look, there is no name that has been revealed under heaven by which man can be saved except the name of Jesus Christ. The exclusiveness of our religion, it's real. Oh, but the inclusiveness is also clear. It doesn't, our faith doesn't bar anyone from coming to salvation. Anyone can come to faith in Jesus Christ. He will not turn anyone away, and he constantly invites you to do so. Because you see, the most important question that you're going to answer in your life isn't, where am I going to go when I die? That may be part of it. The most important question is actually, what do I think of Jesus? Do I believe what he said, that all that he said that he is? Because it's only through Jesus that we can be reconciled through Christ. The wonderful thing about this fellowship is seen in verse 4. And we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. Everything that that John has written before and what he's going to write in the rest of the chapter is so that the joy of the believers will be complete. Now, I want to take us through a couple of verses real quick about what Scripture says about fellowship and about joy. First of all, Christian fellowship is a product of the Holy Spirit. In 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4, there's a famous verse that we usually use for dismissals. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Fellowship is connected to the Holy Spirit. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 1, Paul mentions again that fellowship is in the Holy Spirit, you know. Fellowship is a byproduct of the presence of the Holy Spirit with us. But so also is joy. We've talked about Galatians 5:22 already, that joy is part of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. He produces it in us. We also see in Romans chapter 14, verse 11, it says, for the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Fellowship and joy are something the Holy Spirit produces. Isn't it beautiful, right there, that incarnational assurance leads to a proclamation, and that proclamation creates a fellowship of joy, a fellowship by which the Holy Spirit resides over. I love the fact that the Trinity is in display in these first four voices. The Father and the Son unite us to themselves, and the Holy Spirit creates fellowship and joy within us. It's not, our fellowship is not dreary, it's not dutiful. It is joyful, and it is produced by the Spirit. Charles Spurgeon on this passage said, hear ye this, you people of God. The object of the revelation of Jesus Christ is that you may have joy, that you may have a heart full of joy, and that you may know what full joy means. For here below, we get but drops and dashes of joy, unless we are brought into fellowship with God through Jesus Christ. And then we have the very joy of God in our souls. Oh, the delights of it. Oh, that you could all know of it to the full. John is going to explain what this fellowship looks like, and he's going to explain how to maintain that joy throughout the rest of the book. But know this, Christian fellowship is not a dreary existence. It's meant to be full of abundant joy. I want to leave you with this. We live in a world where there are a lot of questions, right? And as Christians, we have doubts about so many things. And the world is asking those questions and throwing them at us, and sometimes we don't have all the answers. Why does evil exist if God is so good? Does God even exist at all? You know? Is Jesus Christ the only way? Doesn't that seem a little bit, I don't know, unkind of God? All sorts of questions are thrown at us, and they're important questions, and sometimes we have doubts. But the most important question that we need to come back to all the time is Jesus Christ the Son of God? Did God incarnate or not? That's the core of our faith. Because you see, once we have incarnational assurance, everything else revolves around that. All the questions take a different perspective. Because if the incarnation was real, oh, then I don't have to have the answers to all the other questions. I don't. I can rest assured in incarnational assurance because Jesus is who he says he is. And if you are not a believer, this is the question that you need to answer. Is Jesus who he says he is? Did the incarnation actually happen? So I invite you to hear Jesus, to see him in the Gospels, read the Gospels, ask your Christian friends about him, talk to Christians, read some good books about the Gospel. Then contemplate Jesus, behold him, really think deeply about it. And I believe that the Holy Spirit will lead you to embrace Christ as your own. Do the work, because this is a serious question. Will you come to the one who was from the beginning, the eternal life, who became flesh? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let's join together in confessing our faith according to the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified,
died,
and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Clothe your ministers with righteousness.
Let your people sing with joy.
Give peace, O Lord, in all the world.
For only in you can we live in safety.
Lord, keep this nation under your care.
And guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let your way be known upon earth.
Your saving health among all nations.
Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten.
Nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in us clean hearts, O God.
And sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
A collect for Sundays. O God, our King, by the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, on the first day of the week, you conquered sin, put death to flight, and gave us the hope of everlasting life. Redeem all our days by this victory, forgive our sins, banish our fears, make us bold to praise you and to do your will, and steel us to wait for the consummation of your kingdom on the last great day, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And a collect for mission. Lord Jesus Christ, you stretched out your arms of love on the hard wood of the cross that everyone might come within the reach of your saving embrace. So clothe us in your Spirit that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know you to the knowledge and love of you for the honor of your name. Amen. Now let me invite you to pause the video now and take some time to pray, offering up your own petitions and thanksgivings as the Lord leads, and then join us again as we close out this time of prayer. Let's join together in saying the general thanksgiving.
Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen.
Let's sing together. Please stand. Thanks for joining us for worship today. Will you please now join with me in this prayer of St. Chrysostom? Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now may the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.